Hello, Acid Apostles. Well, I'm sure you're busily working on your papers, but you did have reading assignments for this week. And this week we're talking about hermeneutics. Specifically, we're talking about how do we interpret as African Americans? What choices, what particular ways do we go about doing this? How do we, what is this thing that we're doing called interpretation? The big picture of exegesis is part of a larger discipline called hermeneutics. And hermeneutics is the interpretation of things, the whole philosophy of interpretation. The five readings you had this week were to look specifically at how do we interpret scripture? How do we use the Bible as scripture? The first of those readings is by Wilfred Cantwell Smith. He is a white scholar, used to be at Harvard, and he wrote this very famous book called What is Scripture? A Comparative Approach. Smith is making an argument that scripture is actually a verb, that we don't read scripture. Scripture is not given to us. We make scripture. That these ancient texts that we have are not scripture by themselves. They're not scripture because they're in a Bible. They're not scripture because of what they say. They're scripture because the community of faith reads them and uses them to make meaning of their world, to understand how to be in community with the deity, to understand how to be in community with one another, to understand what it is we are to do in the world. That's what makes a text scripture. If a community of faith didn't use a text of scripture, it wouldn't be scripture. That's Cantwell Smith's argument. So the first question then is to look at the Acts of the Apostles. Is this scripture? Do we use it as scripture? Do we use all of it as scripture? Do we only use some of it as scripture? What do we do to make this text scripture? How do we act to it? How does it shape our world? How does it shape our community? How do we go about our daily lives because we have read Acts of the Apostles? So if you're taking the Cantwell Smith position, you're looking at the question of how do we make Acts scripture? What are the things we do? Do we put it in our songs? Do we make it part of our sayings? Do we use it as the major quotes of our churches? How do we make Acts of the Apostles scripture? How do we use it as communities of faith? So that will be the first set of questions. Now, the second set of questions comes from Cleophas LaRue, which looks at how do black people preach Bible? And specifically, in my case, how do we preach Acts? So LaRue argues that we scripturalize by positing that God is good, regardless of what the text says, God is always good. So we start with the premise that God is good all the way through. So even when we see Herod beheading James, we are still going to say God is good. So my question becomes, is that a premise we want to bring to the Acts of the Apostles? We also, according to LaRue, preach by positing the centrality of a univocal scripture. By univocal, I mean that the scripture speaks with one voice, and it was God-authored, and it is in a particular book. So we argue, and some of you write this way, as if the author of John and the author of Acts are saying the same thing and mean the same thing. Now, I'm here to tell you, in biblical exegesis, that's not how it's done. But I see that in the preached moment all the time, how we pull from different books and try to make an argument across different books as if the different books are all saying the same thing to the same communities. The other thing we do is we call people from out of the community who have, we say, the right to speak about these texts, and it's their time to speak. And most of you are in that position. You've either already been called out of the community or you're in the process of being called out of the community. And then we interpret text for the purpose of piety, so that we can be more holy, for the purpose of care of our soul, for the purpose of social justice, for the purpose of corporate concerns, and for the purpose of maintaining the church. So are we then interpreting Acts in these five ways, in any of these five ways? Are we interpreting Acts so we can get more holy? Are we interpreting Acts so that we can care for our soul? Are we interpreting Acts for the purposes of justice? Are we interpreting Acts because of corporate concerns? Are we interpreting Acts for the maintenance of the church? These are questions. So how is this supported by exegesis, and how is it challenged? What does exegesis do similarly to the way that black preaching is always done, according to Cleophas LaRue? And how does exegesis either open up or challenge or push black preaching to go in different directions? So those of you who are being Cleophas LaRue, that's your task, to look at what we're doing and how it connects to black preaching and to the work that Cleophas LaRue puts forward. Now, if you're looking at Katie Cannon, she makes a very simple claim that the whole point of reading scripture is to look at it through the lens of liberation. So she argues that the best way to scripturalize, to use these texts, is to start not just with God as good, but with God as liberator. There's a slight nuance difference here, right? Instead of saying we scripturalize that God is good, we say we scripturalize that God sets people free. Then we claim, as part of our scripturalization, that biblical texts set people free. And then we scripturalize, we read these texts to find solutions to our daily problems, to side with those who are liberators, to affirm God's presence as with us during slavery and oppression. And for Katie Cannon, the whole point of these texts and the whole point of reading these texts is to proclaim liberation. So again, those of you who are taking Katie Cannon's position, what about Acts of the Apostles proclaims liberation, and who is being liberated by it? Is anybody not being liberated by it? How do you know? Randall Bailey, of course, takes us on a history tour. He starts us back in slavery and talks about how, when we were slaves, we didn't take every word of the text because we couldn't read every word of the text. We took what we knew and we liked, and we left alone what we didn't like. The way I tell my intro class is this: you can tell me all you want that African Americans have always been inerrant, but no slave ever wrote a spiritual about slaves obeying their masters. We didn't read every word. We didn't choose every word of this text as scripture. We picked and chose. But when we became literate, when we were able to read, we not only incorporated the language of the Bible into our language. We talked about God being no respecter of persons, right? That's incorporating the language of the Bible into our language. But we also incorporated Eurocentric ideology of the interpreters of the Bible. We started to read like white men, specifically like white men. And over time, we began losing our story and siding with the dominant class. So women started to read against women characters and with the male characters. And descendants of slaves started to read against the slaves and with those who were free. And descendants of those whose communities were attacked and taken over by foreign folks started to read with the oppressors, those who went and took over other communities. So Bailey says that the whole purpose of biblical exegesis is to correct the way that we think about these texts. And he talks about four different ways biblical exegesis has been doing that among African Americans. One is to reclaim the presence of Africa in these texts. Remember that everything that is connected to Turkey and all the way down is actually physically, geographically connected to Africa. There is no break. There's no break between Africa and Europe. It's all one landmass. Why we break between Europe, Africa, and Asia has to do with colorism and has to do with racism, but it has nothing to do with the actual geographic landmass. So this is all African. So reclaiming African presence, reclaiming the presence of the Cyrene, reclaiming the presence of the Niger, reclaiming the presence of the eunuch of the Kandake in Meroe, all of these things become very important. A second trend in biblical interpretation among African Americans is calling out racism. Going through the academy and calling out racist readings, calling out racism in the text, and reclaiming God as liberator. A third way is looking at how we as black people have used the writings, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that when we get to Vincent Wimbush. And the fourth is to think ideologically, which is to read against the text, to ask, to challenge the narrator about what he did not say or what she did not say, to challenge the narrator why this one is a hero and not that one. So to read against the text. Our last scriptural, our last hermeneutical lens is Vincent Wimbush. While Bailey has given us some ways to go at this question of reading the text, Vincent Wimbush is asking, why are we doing this at all? He actually speaks against the whole discipline of commentary that we've been working on the entire time and says commentary veils the experience, the other words, of African American folk. He says here's some questions. When we engage in our commentary and our exegesis of a canon, what structures do we hold in place? And what do we veil or hide? What things do we not want to talk about when we're reading these texts because you know it's the Bible? What do we use to hide things? Are there things that we kind of just gloss over because they're too painful to talk about, too traumatic to talk about? Again, that has to do with how we read, and that may be the thing we need to look at. What would happen if we started reading Acts 2, not through the community gathered in Jerusalem, but through the lenses of the slaves and hush harbors, and the slaves who stood up and preached from the hand? What would happen if we took ourselves as the text for exegesis and measured how we read and used that as the basis for understanding a little bit more of the biblical text rather than the other way around? Well, for full disclosure, for those of you who are going to be on campus in the fall, I'm going to be teaching a course that's just like that. It's going to be contemporary Afrocentric biblical interpretation, and it will be 571, and those of you who are on campus are welcome to take it. I will not be teaching it online. I apologize. But that should give us some things to think about and some things to talk about while you're preparing the final draft of your exegesis paper. So I will see you in the forums, and I look forward to hopefully seeing many of you in person in the future. I thank you for it's been a wonderful class. You all have been great, great, great students and really diligent. And I look forward to more of seeing you online and in person. And thank you very much for this semester. God bless.